Lecture number three. So in this lecture number three, we are going to continue on the coordinate system. So similar to two dimension, we will start with Cartesian coordinate system. So in two dimension, we had two axes, X and Y. Now in three dimension, we have three axes, X, Y, and Z. Similar to two dimension, here also we are going to have unit vectors, but now there will be three unit vectors, unit vector along X, unit vector along Y, and unit vector along Z. These unit vectors, X, Y, and Z, are in increasing direction of X, Y, and Z. The unit vector here, X, unit vector along X direction will be perpendicular to the Y, Z plane. Remember, for two dimension, we said that the unit vector will be perpendicular to a line, but here in three dimension, the unit vector will be perpendicular to a plane. Here, unit vector along Y direction will be perpendicular to the XZ plane. Unit vector along Z will be perpendicular to XY plane. Again, similar to two dimension case, here also in 3D, these unit vectors are going to be orthogonal and directed in the same direction at every point. So these unit vectors are not going to change when we move from one position to another position. These unit vectors also satisfy this condition, that if we take cross product of unit vector X with Y, it gives us unit vector along Z direction. If we do cross product of unit vector Y with Z, we get unit vector along X direction. Unit vector Z cross unit vector X will give us unit vector along Y direction. So this basically satisfies this right-handed cyclic rule, that you can multiply with X and Y to get Z, Y and Z to get X, and Z to X to get Y. So this is right-handed cyclic rule. So this is very simple. This Cartesian coordinate system extension from 2D to 3D is quite easy and simple. Now we will go to the cylindrical coordinate system. And in this cylindrical coordinate system, we locate a point by three parameters, which are known as R, theta, and Z. R, theta, and Z are called coordinates for cylindrical coordinate system. This R is the distance of this point from the Z axis. Or we can also say that this is distance from the origin if we project this point P in XY plane. From this simple algebra, if we project this point in XY plane, the distance from the origin to this point is R. Hence, this distance will be R cos theta, which is X. Similarly, Y will be R sin theta, where theta is the angle made with the X axis. So what I'm saying, I want to repeat once again, that here is the point P. I want to project this point in XY plane. We can do so by putting a perpendicular line with the XY plane, and where it is intersecting, you can denote that point. And then we draw a line between origin to this point. The angle made with this x-axis with this line is called theta. Okay. By the way, our theta coordinate of the foot in xy plane is very similar to the plane polar coordinate system. The z is height of this point P from this xy plane. The unit vectors, we say, is the along this direction, which will be in the increasing direction of r. So this is the distance between this z axis to this point, which is going to be same as this distance, and the unit vector is in the increasing direction of r. Theta is again in the increasing direction of this angle theta, and which will be along this direction. Z is going to be the simple one. It is going to be in the increasing direction of z direction. Okay, so cylindrical coordinate system, once again, note that r, theta and z is at the intersection of the three surfaces. We know that in two dimension, the point is defined by the intersection of two lines. But in three dimension, the points are defined by intersection of three surfaces. And in the cylindrical coordinate system, we define this point by the intersection of three surfaces, and these three surfaces are, first one is cylinder, for example. So r here, if we are talking about, r is the distance from the z axis, and then if we take the locus of the points which are at fixed distance from this z axis, then it will form a cylinder. Another surface is surface with theta is equal to constant, which is plane containing the z axis. So if I want to locate those points which are at constant angle from the x axis, then it will be forming a plane containing the z axis, which will look like this. Okay, so all these points here on this plane is having angle theta with x axis. Another surface is z equal to constant, which is plane perpendicular to the z axis. So all the points here on this plane are having z is equal to constant value. So if we put intersection of these three points, three surfaces, okay, we get the points in the cylindrical coordinate system. When we are talking about surface, it can be, you know, curved also. Generally, plane, we think that the plane is not curved. But in surface, we consider all kind of surfaces which can be curved also. So for example, here we are showing three surfaces. One is curved and two are plane. First one is, which is shown with the green, is for r is equal to constant. Okay, and the value, this constant, r is equal to constant, is increasing with time. Okay, you see this, the radius of this cylinder is increasing with time. Okay. Then we are having another surface which is shown with this red color, and that is basically a plane, and which denotes theta is equal to constant, but that constant is varying with time. Okay, that constant doesn't mean that it will not vary with time. That constant value is not position dependent, but it is fixed, but it is varying with time. And if it is varying with time, so theta is equal to, for example, zero, it will be along this plane here, 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 here coming. This is the value, theta is equal to zero here. And then again, it is increasing with time. Theta is equal to 90 degree. Theta is equal to 180 degree and so on. Here theta is equal to 2 pi and so on. The z value here, z is equal to constant, it is increasing with time. So you see that the value of z is increasing here. So which is shown with this blue surface. So basically, what is the bottom line? Bottom line is the three orthogonal components, r is equal to green. In fact, three orthogonal surfaces, r is equal to green, theta is equal to red, and z, which is denoted by blue, each increasing at a constant rate. The point is at the intersection between these three colored surfaces. Okay. So that's how it is. Now, if we want to transfer from one coordinate system to another coordinate system, so we want to know what is the relation between them. So x is equal to r cos theta. Okay, is the y is equal to r sin theta and z is equal to z. So this is the relation between the cylindrical coordinate system to Cartesian coordinate system. Reverse transformation is also possible, just by simply putting r is equal to square root of x square plus y square. Theta is equal to tan inverse y by x. Okay. So you can go back and forth. If you want to work with cylindrical coordinate system, you can transform using this transformation. Please note that there are many books which follows different notation. So instead of r and theta, they use rho and phi. Okay. This is to make sure that this same notation r and theta is being used in a spherical polar coordinate system. And that's why they want to make sure that, you know, there is no mixed up of notation. And that's why they go for rho and phi. But it's okay. I mean, if we know that we are working in the cylindrical coordinate system and how we are defining r and theta, then there'll be no mix up. Okay, if we understand clearly, then there'll be no mix. So let's talk about the unit vector. So basically, the unit vector for three coordinate system here in the cylindrical coordinate system, unit vector along three coordinates, r, theta, and phi, r, theta, and z, is very simple. It's just you take r and theta as a plane polar coordinate system, and then we have to have another unit vector along z direction. So basically, cylindrical coordinate system is nothing but plane polar coordinate system plus another coordinate along z direction. That's it. So it is going to behave exactly the similar as way as plane polar coordinate system plus additional coordinate. So here r theta and z are unit vectors along increasing direction of the coordinates r, theta and z. Again, unit vector r is given as cos theta x cap plus sin theta y cap. Unit vector along theta direction, which is this, is given as minus sine theta x cap plus cos theta y cap. This one we are very much familiar and we have derived when we were discussing the plane polar coordinate system. There is additional unit vector coming since we are working in three dimension, and that addition is due to this z axis. Again, the unit vectors r, theta and z are orthogonal. The direction of r, theta depends on the location, but z is fixed. So we know that this unit vector r and theta are going to change once you vary the theta, but z is not going to vary. Z is going to be always fixed along z direction. Again, r, theta and z unit vectors are perpendicular to the surface. R is equal to constant. So the unit vector r is perpendicular to the cylindrical surface. Theta constant, so unit vector theta is perpendicular to the plane at angle theta. Okay, the plane is at angle theta with the x-axis and it contains the z-axis. And then z is equal to constant. So this unit vector z is perpendicular to the z is equal to constant plane. That is, the z is equal to constant plane is nothing but parallel to the xy plane. Please note that this is also going to follow this cyclic rule where we multiply with unit vectors r and theta, in fact, the vector product. If we do, we get the unit vector z. Vector product of theta and z will give us the unit vector r. Vector product of unit vector z with unit vector r will give us theta. So these are the property of these unit vectors. If we want to define the position and the velocity of this, we can do so. Vector components are very similar to the polar coordinate plus z component here. So position vector, here we can write r plus r into r cap plus z into z cap. You remember that for plane polar coordinate system, this was the position vector, but we have added now with extra vector, which is along z direction with magnitude z. The velocity is going to be this one by doing the differentiation of this position vector with respect to time. We know that we have done already this part. and we get this much. The extra extra term is coming because of the velocity along z direction. And also we know that dz cap by dt is going to be zero because z unit vector along z direction is not going to be space dependent, and hence it will not depend upon time. The acceleration is going to be again the simple one. We have to add the acceleration in the plane and then along the z direction. This one we have extensively worked. We have extensively discussed this acceleration. Newton's law is going to follow again. We have to decompose the forces along this r cap, theta cap, and z cap direction. And we can simply multiply with mass. And then this is the acceleration term. So that's how it is going to work. So up to now, I don't think that we have done anything that complicated. I mean, up to now, we have just, for the Cartesian coordinate system in 3D, we have simply add z axis. That's fine. We said that it is going to be perpendicular to each other, all these unit vectors. That's fine. And then we introduced cylindrical coordinate system, and cylindrical coordinate system is again very simple one. Once we know that there is plane polar coordinate system, and then we have to simply add another parameter along z direction, and we have to simply add vectorially. So it's quite simple up to now. But the complexity comes here if we discuss the spherical polar coordinate system. But why do you want to do the complicated things? This is because, well, in physics or engineering, I mean, there are many, many problems which are suited for the spherical coordinate system because they are spherically symmetric. And this kind of problems are on various length scale, starting from atomic or even nuclear scale to astronomical scale. There are spherical symmetry, and you have to use the spherical coordinate system to deal these problems. So that's why the spherical polar coordinate system is important, even though it might be a bit inconvenient to understand the coordinate system initially, but at the end, once you understand this coordinate system, it will be quite handy to tackle different kind of physics or engineering problems. And what is that spherical coordinate system? Again, we need three parameters to define a point. And these points are r, theta, and phi. Sorry, by mistake, I have written x, y, and z. That is for Cartesian coordinate system. But this is also, so this point can be represented now by r, theta, and phi. By the way, now this r theta is not same as whatever we have used in the plane polar coordinate system. R is the radial distance from the origin. So here is the point P. The distance from the point P to the origin is r. Theta is the angle made with the z axis. Okay, so if we draw a line from this point to origin, and then we try to measure the angle between this z axis to this line, that is called theta. Then we have to project this point in xy plane. What do I mean when I say projection to xy plane? I draw a perpendicular line from this point in the xy plane, and wherever it intersects in the xy plane, I define that point P here, and then I draw a line from here to origin, okay? And then the angle made with this line with x-axis is called phi, okay? So phi is the angle between x-axis and the projection of the radial vector in xy plane. So that's how we define r, theta, and phi for this coordinate system. Okay. And this is the meaning of this r, theta, and phi. Well, r, theta, and phi are well known as spherical polar coordinates. If you want to measure the distance of this point from z axis, you will be able to write as this distance as r sine theta. The distance of this point from this xy plane will be r cos theta. Since this is r sine theta, this will be also r sine theta, since it forms a rectangle in this plane, okay? A plane which is at angle theta with respect to x and contains the z axis. If I want to find the distance from this point with the x axis, then this will be r sine theta, this distance, and then sine phi. This distance from here to here will be r sine theta into cos phi. This is quite useful to decompose these lengths and know, because okay, so be careful with the notations are different than r and theta in the planar coordinates. So don't confuse with the planar and spherical, even though notation is same. Again, I want to tell you that these points r, theta, and phi is at the intersection of the three surfaces. As I told you that any points in three dimensions are defined by the intersection of the three surfaces. And what are these three surfaces? First is r is equal to constant. So locus of all the points which are at the constant distance from the origin, and that is nothing but a sphere. These are the surface for r is equal to constant. So this is the surface. Now, another point where we say theta is equal to constant, and that is what theta, all the points, okay, which are at constant angle from the z axis, and that will be nothing but a cone, okay. So all the points on this surface, conical surface, will be theta is equal to constant. Another point, another surface, which is phi is equal to constant, and that is a plane. Phi here, this makes angle phi, and then it contains the z axis, and this is the surface. And then this point, P, is on the intersection of these three surfaces defined as this. So all these surfaces, three surfaces, sphere, cone, and plane, I have plotted, and then I have seen the, and if you see the intersection point, I see this point here. Okay, so as I discussed previously, that it is very important to know this geometry, that what will be the distance of this point with z-axis, which is r sine theta. This distance will be r cos theta. So if you do all these exercises, immediately you will be able to find that if the point P is denoted as r theta and phi, if I want to calculate x, y, and z corresponding to this, it is nothing but x is equal to r sine theta cos phi here, this distance. Okay. Y is equal to r sine theta sine phi, and z is equal to r cos theta. So this is the transformation from the spherical polar coordinate system to the Cartesian coordinate system. If you want to go other way, you can go ahead. If we are given x, y, and z, and I want to form spherical coordinate system, we will be able to form like this: r is equal to under root x square plus y square plus z square. This tells us the distance of this point from the origin. Theta, which is telling us the angle made with the z axis of this line as x square plus y square. So this one, the theta is So basically, yeah, I'm a bit confused. So yeah, so theta is basically z, okay. Here, this distance, and then the distance from here to here. Okay, so we can calculate like that. So angle phi is tan inverse y by x. Okay. By the way, this distance is nothing but x square plus y square, because this is just, this length is same as this length. This length is x square plus y square. So this is tan theta is this much, x square plus y square under root divided by z. So this is what it is written here. Okay. So I am going to write this position vector in terms of x, y, and z component. You remember that we wrote the position vector even in the plane polar coordinate system as r cos theta x plus r sin theta y, and so on. Similarly, here also, we are going to write this position vector as r sine theta. Basically, this is x, x cap, y cap, z, z cap. The value of x is r sine theta cos phi. The value of y is r sine theta sine phi from here. And then value of z is r cos theta. So this is the position vector which is written in terms of the Cartesian unit vector, but with the spherical polar coordinates parameters. And why we are doing so? Because we want to define mathematically what is the unit vector. Okay. By the way, the definition mathematically, the definition of the unit vector is unit vector along r direction is the rate of change of the position vector divided by the magnitude of that rate of change. Theta cap is the unit vector along theta, along increasing direction of theta, is rate of change of the position vector with respect to theta divided by the magnitude of the change. Phi is the rate of change of the position vector divided by the magnitude of the rate of change. And if we have to calculate this, we can easily calculate. For example, here I want to calculate r cap. I can do so. Here r is equal to, I have to do the partial differentiation with respect to r, treating all theta and phi to be constant. Anyways, x cap, y cap and z cap are constant. It doesn't depend upon anything. So since I'm doing partial derivative with respect to r, I have to take theta and phi constant. And then you can see this first term will be sine theta cos phi. The second term will be sine theta sine phi. And third term will be cos theta. So we get the unit vector like this. And what is that unit vector? It's here. You can see. This unit vector is perpendicular to the sphere, okay, and like this. Okay, now, by the way, this del r by, if we do del r vector by del r, it is already normalized to 1, okay, length is 1. So really, we didn't have to put this one, but for other one, you will realize that it is not one, and that's why we have to put this. We have to normalize so that this vector has become the magnitude of this vector is one. So, for example, if you want to do theta cap and if you want to do del r by del theta here, then this will become r cos theta here. Cos phi x cap plus r cos theta sine phi y cap plus r minus r sine theta, and then the magnitude will be r is r, and here we have to divide to remove this r magnitude. So what is this unit vector? Theta cap is in the increasing direction of theta. Okay, so this is the direction. By the way, if you want to pictorially do this, you can do so. Unit vector, if you want to do, first you have to project this unit vector in xy plane. So if you project this one in xy plane, what will happen? That so this unit vector along z direction will be minus z minus sine theta, right? Because this is directed in this way, here it is sine theta, but I want to have, so this along this direction it is minus, so that's why this minus sign is coming here, minus sine theta. In the xy plane, it will be cost, it will be having cos theta component in the xy plane. And then further we have to decompose along x and y. So you will be able to find this. But you can do like this also, no problem. But it's very simple. If it is the, this is the unit vector which is given, and you want to project this unit vector along z direction, along x direction and along y direction, you can do so. Just take, project this one along xy plane. If we project in xy plane, it will be having cos theta component. And if you, if you want to project along x direction, it will have cos phi component, and along y it will have sin phi components, as we have done previously, that along x direction this was cos theta term was coming. So similar also it here, it will be coming here, and the direction here will be like this, and then sin theta component, but we want to have direction along z direction, so this will be minus sin here. Similarly, you can get a unit vector along x direction, along phi direction, increasing direction of phi. So you can do mathematically here, you have to simply partially differentiate this r with respect to phi and then normalize it. So if you do like this, this first term will become r sin theta minus sin phi, r sin theta cos phi, and this is not function of phi, okay, so this will become zero, and then we have to divide by r to make sure that it is having length 1. So you can see phi is going to be minus sin phi x cap plus cos phi y cap. It should be also clear that we are talking about the unit vector along phi, which is in the xy plane. Phi is in the xy plane, so you don't expect any component along z direction, so you don't see anything here along which is having component along z. So it is perpendicular to this, so you see that it will have minus sign because it is directed like this in xy plane, so that's why it will be minus sign here, and then it will have sin theta, and then it will be cos theta. So if you do carefully, pictorially also you will be able to do it. If you are really very much scared with this expression, it looks very scary to some of you, because after the class they are asking a lot of questions on this expression, but it is not scary. I mean, this is a, you know, mathematical way of defining the unit vector. Unit vector along these three perpendicular directions of the coordinate system. Please know that the unit vector will be defined, we define the vector divided by the magnitude. But here we are not talking about the unit vector, we are defining the unit vector along the three perpendicular directions. And that's why we have to define like this. This is the definition. Mathematical definition, but pictorially also you will be able to do it, as I explained. You try. Unfortunate thing with 3D is it's a bit hard to visualize initially, but if you do slowly, you will be accustomed to this, and then you will be able to handle a three-dimensional problem. Okay, these r cap, theta cap, and phi cap are perpendicular to r is equal to constant, theta is equal to constant, and phi is equal to constant surfaces. Okay, so this is fine. Again, these unit vectors satisfy some certain cross product rule, and which is given as this, and it is given as r cap cross theta cap is equal to phi cap, theta cap cross phi cap is equal to r cap, phi cap cross r cap is equal to theta cap. Now we know that, I want to know that how these unit vectors are changing. We have to be cautious, because we are trained in the plane polar coordinate system that, hey, these unit vectors r and theta are not fixed as it happens in the case of the Cartesian coordinate system. It is going to vary in space. These unit vectors here in the spherical coordinate system are going to be a function of theta and phi, okay, but not of r. So you can see these unit vectors are, it is function of theta and phi, okay. Theta cap is also unit function of theta and phi, and phi cap is function of x and y only. Well, so you should be knowing that the r cap, the unit vector, does not change if you change the distance from the origin. The unit vectors are going to remain same. But if we vary theta, these unit vectors are going to change. So for example, r cap, rate of change of r cap with theta can be done using this simple mathematics, and you will be able to do this. You will find that rate change of unit vector with respect to theta will give an unit vector which will be along the theta from the mathematics. You can clearly see this. Now, if we do this, the variation of the unit vector r with respect to phi, of course you can do mathematically, and then you can get it like this. Okay. Again, the unit vector theta doesn't depend upon r. Okay. It is going to be constant. Doesn't matter where are you from the origin. If you keep on moving in the same line, the unit vectors are not going to change. The unit vectors with theta, with respect to theta, is going to be minus r cap. By the way, these two are a bit similar and familiar to you, because this one we have already done in the plane polar coordinate system, and it is coming to be in the similar fashion here also. Well, this mathematics looks very scary, and then you think that, do we have to remember this? Well, I mean, this is not scary, and it's not complicated to remember if you conceptually build up this derivative. Okay. Again, if I want to do the variation of this unit vector theta with respect to phi, you will be able to do it here like this. So you take this unit vector theta, do the partial derivative with respect to phi, then you will be able to find this answer. Again, I'm saying that unit vector doesn't depend upon the position. Unit vector doesn't depend upon r. And if we say that this unit vector with respect to theta, you will be able to find this answer. Okay, mathematically you can do so. And then unit vector phi with respect to phi is going to give us r sine theta plus theta cap cos phi. So it's mathematically very straightforward and trivial. Okay. I don't know how much time I have left with. So I'm already on the border. So let's see how this variation of this unit vector comes into picture. For example, if you are doing this r cap with theta, okay? And this one we have already done, so that's why I'm doing here. We have done this kind of picturization in plane polar coordinate system. So again, I'm doing here. Here, I'm saying that I want to vary the position with theta only. Phi is fixed and r is fixed. So if phi is fixed, so it will be, and r is fixed, it is going to be a circle here if I vary. So this variation of this point will be along this circle here. And if I'm varying very small, you can see that the direction of the unit vector here at point P, direction of the unit vector along R will be this. If I vary, I will go to this position, and then I have to do the vector summation or vector subtraction. Then I find this unit vector along theta cap direction. Similarly, if I vary the position from here to here, and then I want to see this, how much unit vector has changed with respect to theta. So you see here, initially the direction is here, and after coming to theta plus delta theta, the vector has become like this. And then if we do the vector subtraction, I find that the rate of change of this unit vector is directed towards the center, and it is along like this. So this is very simple.